thank you for taking the time to talk to me.
I mean, it's an absolute honour to have the opportunity to talk to you. I've listened to your music for years and it's 2021 and here we are. You're releasing a brand new album, The Lockdown Sessions. What keeps you wanting to make new music?
Well, in fact, I didn't.
I had no
thoughts of making an album. I went to Los Angeles from Australia when COVID first happened, and I happened to meet Charlie Puth in a restaurant, and I'd never met him before. And we found out we lived like four doors away from each other in LA.
Wow.
And he said, listen, we're not doing anything. Do you fancy writing a song? And I said, absolutely. He said, I've got a studio, come round. So I went round to his house and wrote After All, which appears on the album.
Yes.
And then the next day I went to my publisher's house, which is next door to his, and did a session for Surfaces, who are two guys from Texas who had a great record called Sunday Best. And I played on their new track and sang on it. And that's the first thing I had ever done by Zoom. And that worked out really well. And then I came back to England and I was asked to do Gorilla's track with Damon Albarn, which I did via Zoom. Arena Sawayama track duet from her album, and I did that in person, and she had to isolate for 2 weeks beforehand.
Oh no.
And then at that same day I did the Miley Cyrus Metallica track via Zoom, and then I went and did the Brits with Ollie Alexander, and I had that, and then I went in the studio and did something with SG Lewis because I love him, and I thought, and then I went to Abbey Road Studios and I did a session playing for Lil Nas X and singing on his track, and then I sang with Glen Campbell at a studio 2, which I'd 54 years prior had played on the Hollies' He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother. And so I thought, this is ridiculous, I've turned into a session musician again and I really like it. And I thought, I had 9 tracks. I thought, I'm gonna go to LA and see if I can make a record. And I used Andrew Watt, who won the Producer of the Year at the Grammys this year and who did the Metallica track.
Yes.
And I went to LA in May and I got to write 5 songs. Actually, I wrote 6, 2 for Eddie Vedder, 2 with Eddie Vedder, 1 for his album, 1 for mine, 1 for Brandi Carlile, 1 for Stevie Nicks, 1 for Stevie Wonder, 1 with Young Thug and Nicki Minaj. And I also did the Jimmy Allen track. He's a young black country singer from America who won the Best Newcomer of the Year at the ACM Awards. So voila, I had a record. And it all started from meeting Charlie Puth. So it's his fault.
Wow. Well, I was going to say, actually, interestingly, one of my favourite tracks on the album is After All with Charlie Puth.
Yeah.
I also love Finish Line with Stevie Wonder.
Oh, it's great.
And Soul and Car is incredible. But this isn't the first time you've worked with Stevie Wonder and Stevie Nicks, is it?
It's the first time I've worked with Stevie Nicks. And we've been friends for a long time, but never got to work with her. But Stevie Wonder, he played harmonica, and I guess that's why they call it the blues. And then I did That's What Friends Are For with him and Gladys Knight and Dionne Warwick. But it's the first time we've actually made a duet together.
Yes.
And it all came together. I wrote the song, very unusually, a melody first, because I always write to lyrics. And so I had the song, and I then got the lyrics and sang the song. I played electric piano. He came in, I thought, it's a great song for him to play harmonica on. So he came in and played harmonica like no one else can ever do. Then he played real piano on it. So there's 2 pianos, him and me. And then we put the gospel choir on it, which is Kanye West gospel choir.
Oh, no way.
And then I said to Stevie, listen, he saw it, heard it and said, okay, I'll do the vocal. And so it all came as a result of just putting things on it. But I actually spoke to him this morning. He called me this morning at home and in the middle of the night. But he's just such a great... I've got energy, but he's got energy to burn. It was such an honor. The thing I love about this track, Fleur, is that he sounds as if he's singing on Superstition. His voice sounds so young, isn't it? It's just, and you know, he's just otherworldly. He's got more talent than all of us put together. So it was a real honor, and he's just the most wonderful person. And it was just a thrill for me, as you can imagine.
I actually wanted to ask you, because there's so much diversity on this album. Yeah. Just the different styles, the different genres. You worked with, obviously, seasoned, experienced performers and then new artists. What's the difference working with the 2 different classes of artists?
Well, I was so excited to work with Charlie Puth because I'd never worked with him, and Surfaces. Working with new artists is, you know, I do my own radio show, so one of my big things in life is trying to play records by new artists. Mm. And then I did Rina Sawayama, who I love to death, and then I did SG Lewis, and then I did Jimmy Allen, and Lil Nas X, or who's not necessarily a new artist, but he is a young artist.
Yes.
So working with younger artists is, you know, they all knew what they wanted. So they all told me what to do. When you're a session musician, you're playing on someone else's record, it's very important not to go mad. And I tend to go mad. And they say, can we have a little bit less of Elton? And we want Elton, but we want it to fit in with what we're doing. And it's great because people who know what they want, it takes the time, cuts the time in half. And I really loved it. But of course, working with Stevie Nicks and Young Thug, I've known since Atlanta. He lives in Atlanta and I've met him in Atlanta. And he sampled Rocket Man and did a song called High. And so he happened to be in LA. I was so lucky. He happened to be in LA. Nicki lives in LA, Nicki Minaj. Brandi Carlile happened to be in LA. Stevie Nicks lives in LA. Stevie Wonder lives in LA. And Eddie Vedder was in LA making preparations for an album. So I got really lucky. But it's just, it's a joy to work with other people and other artists. It's so wonderful, especially when they've got the talent. S.G. Lewis, I've loved for a long time. And I went in with Sam in London and put a track down. And it was more like an Elton traditional song. And when it came back, I said, Sam, you need to make it sound like S.G. Lewis and just cut the song up and do what you want with it. And he did. And it made it into Orbit, which is great. And I got the real S.G. Lewis. That's what I wanted. But I made it, when I wrote the song, it was too Elton John-ish. And I just said, listen, do what you want. Like Pernell. Pernell made Cold Heart. This is a great story. And they sent it to me and I thought, this is great. But we need someone to sing the Rocket. I think it's going to be a long, long time because I've sung it so many times. Dua Lipa, who I love, and did our Oscar broadcast this year. And I got to know her and love her and cherish her because she's so brilliant. Humble, talented, professional. She happened to be in LA in May and we took her to dinner and we mentioned the track and she said, well, I'm coming to the end of the future nostalgia cycle. Send it to me, I'll see what I think. And David, my husband and manager, said, when you play it by the pool loud. And she was staying in Malibu. 2 days later, she rang us from Malibu by the pool and said, I'm in. And, you know, she gave the record the kick it needed. And, of course, it's turned into a really successful song for me. So I can't thank her enough. And she starts the album off, and then we go into Young Thug and Nicki Minaj. And, you know, there's so many different artists on this track. So it's not going to be for everybody, but someone's going to like something on it, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I can imagine, not surprisingly, that majority, if not all the people, obviously, that you worked with on this album with, saw you, heard about the opportunity and thought, wow, this is Sir Elton John. But I want to ask you, who are you most excited about working with on the album?
Yeah, Rina Sawayama, Damon Albarn, because I've been a fan of Damon and Blur and his solo, all the things he does. I think he's the most adventurous and, you know, he does things because he loves them. Young Thug and obviously Nicki, because I'd never done that kind of genre before.
Little
Nas X,
cool.
Who I met at the iHeart Awards when I went there. Sam Lewis, singing with Glen Campbell was really, because that's an old song. Glen Campbell's track is the last song he ever wrote, and it's about Alzheimer's and about his last song to his wife. And the lyrics will make you weep. And when it came out 10 years ago, I actually said that this is such one of the most beautiful songs, and his family said thank you for doing that. And so when they came up with the idea of doing his last album with other people doing duets, they asked me to do that track, and I felt very honored because I've always loved Glen Campbell because he was such a great musician. He played on the Beach Boys records. He was part of the Wrecking Crew, apart from what he did during his own life. So Stevie Nicks, I mean, Brandi Carlile, I'm a huge Brandi Carlile fan. Eddie Vedder, I've always been a Pearl Jam fan. I've known Eddie for a long time. We've been friends for a while, but I've never got the chance to make music with him. So every single track, Ollie Alexander,
Made
the Brits with him. It was such a blast. And that's one of the great songs of life. It's a Sin, which is the Pet Shop Boys song. So every track, every artist presented me with a different challenge.
I mean, it's just such an incredible body of work. I absolutely love it. And when I saw artists like Young Thug, Nicki Minaj on there, I thought, what? Oh my gosh, Elton John, wow, this is so cool.
Old Fart makes record with Nicki Minaj and Young Thug, right?
It's just so cool. Like, I just love it. I love it.
These are the kind of artists that keep me young. And I listen to all new music. I know all the old music, but it's the new music in life that keeps me inspired and all these new artists that come along. When you think that Lorde made an album at 16, which was amazing, that Billie Eilish did when she was 15, there's a new artist called Morgan, M-O-R-G-E-N. She's from Santa Cruz. She's made two singles that I played on my record. And she's like, I can't believe a 16-year-old girl is making this kind of music. It's astonishing. So, it, you know, I find them so inspiring. And to get to work with them is even more inspiring because we have fun. Yeah, the whole thing was fun. It was fun. And I hope that comes across on the record.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's actually well known that you're quite a mentor to a lot of emerging artists. And why do you think it's so important to sort of guide them through the industry?
It's tough for them, but they keep me inspired. And I can give them... I was playing Mabel on my show in 2015 before she started having a commercial success. And I interviewed her yesterday on my show. And I've always loved her. And it's so great to see her win a Brit and see her climb... You know, it's like Billie Eilish. I played her first single. I played Rina Samayo. And Rina's now got the lead part in the new John Wick movie. And yes. You just watch them grow and you watch them. Anything I can do to help push them in a direction. They have the talent to go their own way. But it's, you know, I remember when I first went to America, Fleur, and I had so many wonderful people that I admired, like George Harrison, the Beach Boys, the band, Leon Russell, Neil Diamond, all sent me messages, all came to see me, Linda Ronstadt. It gives you affirmation. And affirmation when you're young that you're doing the right thing. You must have had that in your life as well. When someone said you're actually doing really well, and it gives you so much more confidence.
Yeah.
And it's important to give back to young artists like that. At the moment, my big beef is, you know, they can't tour in Europe at the moment. So I'm trying all my best to try and get the government to change the rules, because at the moment, if you're a young artist and you're British, you can't financially afford to go to Europe. There's so much rigmarole and red tape. It's okay for me and the Ed Sheerans of the world. We have a huge conglomerate, you know, operation behind us, but for young artists, and it's really desperate, because if you're a young artist, you have to play live, and playing live makes you grow as an artist. You write better songs, you go to different cultures, you soak in the cultures, and it's really the biggest bee in my bonnet at the moment. So, you know, I have to concentrate. Now I'm back from holiday. I have to really get my butt in shape and get that, hopefully, get a resolution in some respect or get some progress done.
Yeah, I mean, it's just great that you're advocating for that and you're so passionate about that. And now your final tour, the farewell Yellow Brick Road tour.
Yeah, it's the final. You know, it hit the buffers in Australia. We did our last show March the 7th, 2020, and I haven't really done anything since. Like most people, I mean, it's not just me. And I actually enjoyed the lockdown so much with my children and David. It made me think about my life and what I wanted to do with my life. But it will be good to go out and finish it. I've done over 186 shows, I think, or something like that. And we're due to start again in Copenhagen on the 28th of September, which I'm touching wood will happen. Yeah. Things seem to change from day to day, so you never know. I'm in America now, it's getting crazy. But, you know, I'm not in control of it, but I just desperately want to get out there and play to people because I love doing that. And I want to finish the tour in 2023 with a bang and go out like that, because I won't be touring after that. So it's important to finish what I started.
What can we expect then from the final shows? Because I'm sure you're going to be pouring so much love into this tour.
It's going to be very emotional and very joyous, because I played a charity show for Chris Evans for 120 people not so long ago, and they went crazy. And I think people, you saw what happened at Reading and Leeds, people loved it, people went crazy. They love music. Yeah. I loved going to live shows. You miss it, you miss, you know, going nuts. It's a way of letting off steam, and music is such a healer, and it brings people together. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to, it's the unknown, but I think people, not just for me, but people will go crazy for everybody at the moment, because it's, you know, look what happened with the ABBA record.
Yes.
You know, the ABBA record brought people back to a beautiful time in their lives, and it reminded them during this really awful time that there is joy in the world. And whether you like the ABBA record or you like ABBA or not, you have to say this is a good thing, because it, you know, it reminded people that there are good things in life. And, you know, and that's what music does. And that's what I've tried to do with this album, is to say, you know, I wasn't intending to make an album, but boy, have I had I've loved music. It's been my constant thing in my life. It's been my savior. It's been my inspiration. And I haven't changed from when I was 4 years old and I was buying 78s or getting records to the present day. I've been so blessed and so lucky to have music in my life that much.
What do you want the fans to walk away with from this final tour? What kind of experience do you want them to have?
I want them to have happy memories and talk about it to their kids and say, he really cared about us, because I do care about my fans and I always give 150% if I can. I just want them to have a joyous time. And I want them to go back and maybe listen to some things they haven't heard before on my old catalogue. And that's something that David, my husband, has been concentrating on, streaming and stuff like that, keeping me relevant for my boys when I stop. and it's been successful because, you have to acknowledge that things change. People don't buy CDs much more, they buy vinyl, and they're buying cassettes, can you believe
yes.
that?
Yes.
I mean, who would have thought?
I don't.
But, it's music has changed, and you have to follow the changes, and you have to accept it. And that's also very exciting. I love it.
It's really cool. So let's look into the future. It's the final night of your final tour. You hear the crowd roar. They're asking for that encore. How are you going to be feeling in that moment?
I don't know. I never know how I'm going to feel, but shows have a tendency to surprise you. And it's a long way off, so I'm not going to project how I'm going to feel, but I will be feeling very emotional.
I'm sure. And I don't know. I'm not so sure that this is the final one. I've got to say.
I can assure you it's the final two. I can assure you it's the final two. I will be doing some charity shows if I'm asked, but I'm not touring again, Fleur. I'll be 76 when I finish. I need to be with my family. My boys will be teenagers. I will always make music. I'll always be doing my radio stuff and whatever. But I've been playing music since I was 17 professionally. And that's 57 years. Oh, it'll be 59 years by the time I finish. Wow. I've had enough applause. I can't do a better show than I'm doing at the moment. And so I'm really adamant that I'm not touring again. I can't.
So what's next then after the final tour?
Who knows? Well, who knows? Life's full of surprises. I wasn't expecting to do a record this year, and look what happened. So that's the great thing about life. It's one phone call can, like The Lion King, that changed my life. I got a phone call from Tim Rice. Would you write The Lion King? Sure, I would. Look what happened. You never know what the phone's going to,
Just so many surprises from you. So, wow.
And that's what I love about life. I didn't think I'd be talking to you this year promoting an album, but here I am talking to Fleur. So it's great.
I am talking to you. And
well,
it's been such a pleasure.
Yeah. Oh, listen. It's lovely to see you, and congratulations on all your success.
Thank you very much. Congratulations to you, and all the best for the final tour. And I can't wait for everyone to hear the album, because it's amazing.
Thank you so much, and it's a pleasure to see you.